My name is Frank Domino. I'm a family physician in the Department of Family Medicine and Community Health at the University of Massachusetts Medical School. Unnecessary medical tests and procedures have two big problems. The first is their economic cost, their financial burden that they place on everyone. For example, there's some data that estimates maybe $5 to $6 billion a year are spent on unnecessary tests. This comes out of everyone's pocket. It hurts us when we pay our insurance policies, and it hurts us when we pay our taxes. The other big concern is the personal costs. The harms of many unnecessary tests far outweigh the benefits. And when you do an unnecessary test and you get an abnormal result, the next likely step is to do another test to determine what gave you that abnormal result. Abnormal tests and unnecessary tests lead to a great deal of suffering. Let me give you an example of an unnecessary test. Prostate cancer screening has been done in the U.S. for many, many years, yet most of the rest of the world stopped doing prostate cancer screening because the data demonstrated that the harms were greater than the benefits. Last year, almost every major medical organization in the United States came out against prostate cancer screening. This includes the American Cancer Society. The medical director of the American Cancer Society estimates that a patient is 48 times more likely to be harmed than benefited by prostate cancer screening. Yet we do it all the time. Patients still have that expectation, and the physicians and healthcare providers worry that if they don't do it, something bad may happen. Patients should rely on their relationship with their doctor and being an informed consumer. Healthcare providers want to help their patients. Most of us are here, went into the profession to help patients live a healthier, longer life. A number of influences have come into play that have changed that dynamic a bit. For example, doing unnecessary tests sometimes makes the doctor or the patient feel more comfortable that nothing bad is wrong. That relieves the anxiety of the patient and relieves the anxiety of the doctor. Sometimes we prescribe medicines when we know that the problem at hand will get better on its own. When patients are placed in a situation where they're unsure what the doctor's recommending is a good idea, they should ask about it. Tell me, please, what are the benefits? What are the harms of this? Do I absolutely need it? What happens if it doesn't work or if something abnormal occurs as a result of it? Many people ask, well, gee, isn't doing more a good thing? And there's pretty good data that we now have that shows that doing more is not always better. Let me give you a great example. For many years, we've known that if you've had a heart attack or a stroke, putting you on a cholesterol-lowering medicine lowers your risk of having a repeat heart attack or stroke. Well, doctors began thinking, well, if it helps then, we should probably give it to people before they have a heart attack or stroke to help prevent the first one. So for many, many years, we treated people in this manner. Thanks to a new process of looking at medical data, we realized that very, very few people receive benefit from taking cholesterol-lowering medicine if they have not yet had a heart attack or stroke. Yet, changing that behavior both on the patient side and on the physician side is going to take many years.